turn midnight. Brought to you by Ovaltine. Chocolate-flavored Ovaltine. Delicious, nutritious, instant Ovaltine. The fortified food drink that tops them all.
Now for a visit to the Secret Squadron Hall of Fame.
Well, here we are, Pat, Peggy. Every one of these great athletes is a member of the Secret Squadron.
Gee, Crazy Legs Hirsch.
Yes, one of football's all-time greats. And Duke Snyder, a real big leaguer and home run slugger for the Brooklyn Dodgers. Peggy, you should know who this is.
Florence Chadwick.
Yes. Florence holds the world's record for swimming the English Channel, the only woman ever to swim it both ways. Let's join her on the beach. Florence, how do you keep yourself in condition?
By getting plenty of sleep, exercise, and the right kind of foods. And I drink chocolate-flavored Ovaltine. Remember, I said Ovaltine. An athlete wants real nourishment, not just a flavoring for milk or a drink with just a few vitamins.
Right, Florence. Athletes do need the right kind of nourishment, and Ovaltine gives you extra vitamins, minerals, and other important food elements.
And chocolate-flavored Ovaltine is delicious, too.
Right again, Florence. Boys and girls, drink your Ovaltine every day. Just as Florence Chadwick says, get chocolate-flavored Ovaltine.
On a mountaintop high above a large city stands the headquarters of a man devoted to the cause of freedom and justice. A war hero who has never stopped fighting against his country's enemies. A private citizen who is dedicating his life to the struggle against evil men everywhere. Captain Midnight.
This is a very interesting device, Tut.
Well, that demonstrates a principle we may find use for someday.
What is it?
It's a radiation concentrator.
Looks like a piece of glass to me.
It's a lens, Icky. And just as the lens in a magnifying glass will concentrate the rays of the sun in order to create fire, so this lens will concentrate the radiations in fissionable material to do the same thing.
Show him how it works, Tut.
You see this stuff right here? That's a piece of uranium-bearing ore. That's one of the fissionable materials in its raw state. Now, you see this block of wood?
Well, sure, I see it. It's a piece of wood.
Yeah, but you watch what happens when I put the lens between the rock and the wood.
Hey, say, that's pretty good. I bet every Boy Scout in the world would like one of those things for starting fires.
The only trouble with that, Icky, you'd have to have a chunk of radioactive material before you could use it.
Oh, yeah. Joy killer. We got company. You know him?
Yes, it's Mr. Hobson. He's an important intelligence official from Washington. Let him in, Icky.
Any suggestions for improving this?
Well, if we could build up the X factor of the Zebulon element, we might be able to generate a heat of really useful intensity.
We could try.
Let me play around with this for a while, Ted.
Good morning, gentlemen.
Hello there, Mr. Hobson. How are you?
Nice to see you again.
This is Ichabod Mudd, my co-pilot and general assistant.
Mr. Mudd.
And this is Aristotle Jones, my lab man.
Mr. Jones.
Pleasure, sir.
Sit down, won't you?
Thank you.
Now, what brings you here, Mr. Hobson?
Well, I'm on a secret assignment to investigate an unlicensed and very unfriendly radio transmitter that's been operating south of the border.
You say has been operating. What's the problem?
It went off the air last Wednesday.
Well, if they're not sending messages, you got nothing to worry about.
On the contrary, it's when an enemy station is off the air that we worry about it. Now that we've broken their code, we want to know what they're saying.
And who they're saying it to.
That's right.
Have you any idea why it went off the air?
This transmitter is located in a rather remote section of Mexico. And it's our guess they're having difficulty getting the necessary repairs made.
Well, usually these enemy radio stations are headquarters for bigger things.
Just before this station went off the air, they sent an incomplete message referring to shipments of fissionable materials. We must know what this message is about. It may be of vital importance to the entire Western Hemisphere.
Mr. Hobson, we'd like to volunteer to help.
I was hoping you'd say that. But, how would you operate?
Well, we could go to Mexico. Mickey and I could be traveling fix-it men.
An excellent idea. As fixed men, you'd be free to travel anywhere without arousing suspicion.
We'll work in an area where we know their transmitter's located. They'll bring their set to us to be repaired, we hope.
Well, at least that's the theory.
And I can monitor the transmitter from here.
There's one thing I must warn you about. These men are dangerous. And if they find out what you're really up to, well, I don't think they'd stop at anything.
We'll chance that.
I'll arrange to have the truck with all your equipment in it when you get there. Good luck. And be careful.
Thank you. We will.
Mexico, here we come. Hey.
We put down the Santa del Rio?
I filed a flight plan to Dos Flores. That's the nearest airport to Santa del Rio, and that's where Mr. Hobson said he'd have our equipment waiting for us.
Good.
Dos Flores Airport. It's jet aircraft 7700, 13 miles southwest of the field, 8,000 feet. Landing instructions. Over. Well, there it is, just like Mr. Hobson said it would be.
Yeah, he sure did make all the arrangements, didn't he?
We repair everything. Radio's our specialty.
Everything? That takes in a lot of territory. Yeah, but it's good bait to catch our fish.
Transmitter, we can monitor it with this.
We can also use it to get in touch with Mr. Hobson if we have to.
I said we might find them around Santa del Rio. Already. Let's see what we can do with this thing.
Senor Davis, this is Nico.
Yeah, what's up, Nico?
There are a couple of Americans in town with a fixie truck. They say they can fix anything, especially radios.
This may be the break we need. Look, don't let them out of your sight. I'll be there in a half hour. Oh, Nico, make sure these guys are all right. We don't want any trouble.
Buenos dias.
Yeah, looks like I might.
I have something I want you to fix.
Oh, well, step right up. We fix anything.
These watches have great sentimental value. My father stole it from Pancho Villa.
Well, I'll tell you, my man's busy right now, but I'll be glad to fix it. No, no. Huh? Don't worry, don't worry. Mi especialidad. Springboard. Not shockproof.
Caramba! You broke my watch. I kill you.
Hold it. Hold it, amigo. What seems to be the trouble?
Ah, this hombre es loco en la cabeza. He take my good watch to fix, the watch my father stole from a most distinguished hombre. And instead of fixing it, It make you go poof. And the little parts that are supposed to be inside come outside. Just like that.
Well, Lily, Gallant Caballero accept our most humble apologies. Accidents sometimes do happen.
But what about my watch?
That's a very simple matter, senor.
Hey.
Accept this replacement with our esteem and the compliments of Senor Mudd and myself.
Muchas gracias. Muchas gracias. We ought to watch. She never work anyway.
You are in business here in Mexico, senor?
Yes, we are, sir.
Then you will oblige to show me your work permits.
Of course. Hickey, show the captain our work permits.
Right. Is he kidding? I don't have any work permits.
I told you to bring them.
Yeah, but I thought a work permit was a gag, like a left-handed monkey wrench or a cloud stretcher. I just wondered if a guy need a permit to work.
I'm sorry, Captain. It seems that my partner has neglected the permits.
In that case, I will have to ask you to accompany me to the carcel.
Carcel? What's that?
The jail.
Oh, jail?
You are pleased to accompany these motorcycle officers.
This is a pretty kettle of fish. We come down here on an important mission and get ourselves slammed into the clink because we don't have any work permits. Look, we're wasting time. Why don't you pay our fine so we can get out of here?
Because I want to see what might happen.
I'll tell you what'll happen. Our beards will grow so long, nobody will recognize us.
Now, take it easy. I have a hunch there's more to this arrest than appears on the surface.
Look,
Senores, come outside and enjoy some of our fine Mexican sunshine.
You mean you're letting us out of here?
That is right, senor. A friend of yours has put up the money for your fine.
Hey. A friend of ours?
Hiya, guys. Captain give you the good news?
He sure did.
Yes, he did, and we're much obliged. But why should you do this for us?
Well, you don't suppose I'd let a couple of Americans rot in jail without doing something about it, do you? My name is Davis, Henry D. Davis. I'm in the exporting business down here.
I'm Jim Albright. This is my partner, Ichabod Mudd.
You can call me Icky.
Hi, Icky. Say, I see by your truck outside you fellas are fix-it men.
What do you have in mind?
An electric shaver. I can't find anyone in this burg that's even seen one, let alone fix it.
Tell you what we'll do. Since you've been so nice to us, we'll fix your shaver for free.
It's a deal. Say, why don't you be my guest? Nothing I'd like better than to shoot the breeze with a couple of guys from the States.
Fine.
I have my car outside. Why don't you get in your truck and follow me?
We'll be right behind you.
He's a pretty nice fella, huh?
Boys and girls, watch Johnny Jones as he shows you what Captain Midnight means when he tells you to drink instant Ovaltine for rocket power. Now, later, here's Johnny with his friend Wilbur. As you know, Johnny lives up to the Secret Squadron pledge to drink Ovaltine every day. But Wilbur isn't a Secret Squadron member. He doesn't get the proper foods, and he doesn't know that Ovaltine is a real food supplement. See what happens when they start the race. There goes Johnny, rocket-powered. But poor Wilbur, he's out of gas. He just doesn't have what it takes. You see, Ovaltine is more than just a flavoring for milk. Ovaltine contains important amounts of vitamins, minerals, and other food elements to help give you rocket power and to help you be like Captain Midnight himself. Ask your mother to get you instant chocolate-flavored Ovaltine today and be a loyal member of the Secret Squadron and a leader in your gang. Why don't you start drinking Ovaltine today?
This is it.
What do you manufacture here?
Mexican pottery. Big market for the stuff in Europe.
Say, I'd like to take a look at some of it.
Well, there's not much to see. Well, this is my warehouse, office, and what have you.
Where did this come from?
Well, that piece is from the state of Pueblo.
Oh, I thought you said you manufactured the stuff yourself.
Well, we do, some of it. But let's not talk about pottery, unless you're interested.
Well, I am interested in it. Do you use local clay?
Well, I had no idea you had so much interest in pottery. I'll show you around if you like. But first, I'd like you to have a look at my radio.
Radio?
Yeah, I'm a radio ham. About the only means I have of talking to Americans and keeping in touch with the States.
What seems to be wrong with it?
You'll have to tell me. Santo Del Rio is no place to get it fixed. Take a look at it, will you?
See you, Davis.
Oh, excuse me a minute. See what you can do with it, will you? I'll be right back.
Okay.
This is it. This is what we've been looking for.
I can't believe Davis is an enemy. He's too nice a guy.
But the evidence is all against him. Look at these call letters. 62Y40. Well, let's see how quickly we can get this thing back into operation so that Mr. Hobson can tune in that message. Fissionable materials. Fissionable materials. I wonder.
In this building?
I don't know. I'm going to take a look around. First, I'm going to get some tools from the truck. Pretend like you're working on the transmitter.
Okay.
So you're just fix-it men, are you? With a powerful radio hidden in a panel truck?
Well, we're just radio enthusiasts like you.
You're a pretty smart guy, Captain Midnight.
So you know who I am?
Yeah, I know who you are, and now I know you really can fix that transmitter. Get inside and get busy. Hey, what is this? Don't ask questions. Get that set fixed.
No, hold it. They got us covered.
That's talking sense. If this transmitter isn't in good working order when you're through...
It'll be in perfect working order.
What sort of an American are you anyway?
I'm not an American. It's just convenient for me to seem to be one. Keep them covered, Nico. And watch out for them. They're tricky customers.
Alone. You want the radio fixed or don't you? Hold these.
No. Just stay where you are. I will help you myself.
Okay. You got them?
See, I have them.
Snap it off. Get that rope, Vicky. Tie him up.
You hombres won't get away with this. I promise you, you would pay for it!
Ah, shut up.
Put him in that chair.
Come on.
I'll leave you to fix the radio. Run a new lead to the condenser. You're back on the air.
Okay.
Put out a tone signal so that Mr. Hobson and Tuttle know the set's back on the air.
Who do you think you're playing with, school children?
Get everything you can and load it on the truck right away. This will be our last shipment.
But what's the hurry?
Captain Midnight has come here, and that means someone is suspicious of our activities.
Well, who could suspect that the clay of which these simple pots are made of contain radioactive materials?
I don't know, but I won't feel safe here any longer. When the radio is fixed, I'll get through to Captain Zabarkin on the ship, arrange for him to meet us on the coast. We've got to get out of here today.
Thank you.
work. All right, tie him up. Well, he's detected the presence of our fissionable material. We'll be miles out to sea before he can tell anyone about it. All right, come on. Get your hands up. Don't make a move. Get him untied.
What's that you say, hombre, about school children?
Oh, no, no. High school graduates I was talking about. Okay.
62Y40 calling Captain Zabakin on the SS Grovich. The last of the pottery is on its way, Captain Zabakin, and I'm leaving immediately. Prepare to take us aboard your ship as soon as we arrive on the coast. That is all. Out.
I'm all tied up. Davis just left. He talked to a ship at sea.
Tell me later. We've got to catch him.
To set up the roadblock just at the right moment.
I will let our friend Captain Midnight explain.
Well, as you know, Ikey, the United States and Mexican governments work very closely together in matters concerning hemisphere defense.
Very closely, senores.
When Davis sent out that message on the repaired transmitter, the Capitan was listening.
You were?
But of course. You have been watched ever since Mr. Hobson arranged with us for that truck that you found waiting for you.
By one of the Capitan's men, Detective Sergeant Gonzalez.
A detective?
Oh. And this one belongs to you.
I thought I'd never see it again.
When Detective Gonzalez noticed one of Davis's men watching our fix-it truck with unusual interest, he arranged to have us jailed to bring Davis out into the open.
And you will be pleased to learn that the man referred to as Captain Zavakin has been apprehended in a coastal port and the entire shipload of radioactive pottery confiscated.
You've done a great job.
Without your help, Captain Midnight, our success would have been impossible. May your people and ours always work together in harmony for the preservation of our common ideals.
Captain, I speak for all Americans when I say I share your wish.
Now for a visit to the Secret Squadron Hall of Fame.
Gee, the Secret Squadron Hall of Fame.
Yes, Jack, and every one of these great athletes is a member of the Secret Squadron. For example, Crazy Legs Hirsch, one of football's all-time greats. And Florence Chadwick, world-famous English Channel swimmer. And here is Duke Snider. His four home runs during the 1955 World Series led the Brooklyn Dodgers to their first world championship. Let's join Duke in the clubhouse. Duke, what do you do to keep yourself in top condition?
Well, Captain Midnight, I get plenty of sleep, exercise, and the right kind of foods. And I drink chocolate-flavored Ovaltine. Remember, I said Ovaltine, not one of those imitation milk flavorings, or the other kind with just a few vitamins.
That's right, Duke. Ovaltine's got what it takes. 27 vitamins, minerals, and other essential food elements that make Ovaltine such a rich source of nourishment.
And Ovaltine tastes good, too.
Right again, Duke. Boys and girls, drink your Ovaltine every day, just as Duke Snider says. Get chocolate-flavored Ovaltine. Now, get your pencil and paper ready for our three-word secret clue to next week's exciting adventure. Write down these numbers. First word. 3, 8, 18, 7. Second word. 7, 5, 2, 5, 4, 1. Third word. 8, 9, 5, 3, 8, 5, 22, 7. Now, set your decoder for C9 and solve next week's exciting adventure. See you next week. Out. Join the Secret Squadron and wear this official badge and have this secret decoder. Following each week's adventure, I'll send an important secret message, and only Secret Squadron members who have decoders can decode them. Also, later I'll tell you the simple rules for joining the Secret Squadron, but you must promise to do as I do. Keep yourself healthy and mentally alert. And drink Ovaltine every day. It's the official drink of the Secret Squadron. We Secret Squadron members know chocolate-flavored Ovaltine helps give us what we need for rocket power. Yes, just as a rocket adds thrust during takeoff, Ovaltine can add the kind of nourishment so important for rocket power. We drink Ovaltine hot for breakfast. Mmm, good too. And cold for lunch and between meal snacks. And hot again at bedtime to help keep us revved up with rocket power. Believe me, Ovaltine's got what it takes to help you be a leader in your gang. So drink instant Ovaltine every day.
On a mountaintop high above a large city stands the headquarters of a man devoted to the cause of freedom and justice. A war hero who has never stopped fighting against his country's enemies. A private citizen who is dedicating his life to the struggle against evil men everywhere. Captain Midnight.
Here it is. All ready for testing. You know, your suggestions work fine. Using transistors instead of tubes, I was able to build it a lot smaller than my original model.
Yeah, well, the smaller the better.
Mm-hmm. And yet it does all the work of a full-size television camera.
What about the microphone?
It's built in.
Say, this is pretty clever. What kind of an image did you get with it?
Perfect. No distortion at all. Here, I'll show you.
Here comes Icky. Let's try it out on him. Oh, Icky, there's a new television show coming on. Would you like to watch it?
Well, sure. What's it about?
A monkey that acts like a man.
I don't see any monkey.
You don't? Well, here. Just step over a little closer at the screen. About there.
You're funny like a monkey. Hey, that's me. How do I get in television?
Icky, this is our brand new miniature television camera and transmitter, all in one.
That little gadget?
Mm-hmm.
You know, it won't be long before every home in the country will have one of those.
What'll they do, make television programs at home?
No, a mother can go about her housework and watch her children out at play.
Sure, a factory manager can supervise his employees without having to walk through the plant.
Hey, that's pretty neat, you know? Boy, I wish I had one of those when I was going to school. I could have used it during the tests.
Used it during the tests?
Yeah, I would have rigged one over the teacher's desk and see all the answers.
Oh, no.
Hey, we have company.
It's a boy.
Yeah, and he's stealing apples from our tree. I'll take care of him.
Maybe the poor kid's hungry. Wonder who he is.
I don't know. He's a cute little fellow.
Yeah.
Icky will be here with him in a minute.
Well, here he is.
Now, what were you doing on our property?
I didn't think you'd mind, Captain Midnight.
You, know who I am?
Everybody knows Captain Midnight. It's the first food I've had since I left home last night.
You mean you haven't been home all night?
Yes, sir.
What is your name?
I don't want to go home.
Well, if you won't tell us your name, we'll have to charge you for that apple.
Yeah, guess so. It'll be 10 cents, please.
Five, six, seven. 7 cents.
What do you think, Tut?
Well, I guess that ought to be all right.
I guess I won't charge for that apple after all. Jimmy Gibson.
How did you find out?
Secret Squadron member is 754.
James Gibson. I saw that name just the other day. In a magazine.
What is your telephone number?
Please don't call my father.
Jimmy? Is that your father?
Yes, sir.
You asked Jim, expert, to cut $1 million Brazilian diamond in Rio de Janeiro last week to examine the 720-carat stone recently discovered in the Bahia diamond mines. James Gibson shows how he will start cutting the gem when it's delivered to him in the United States.
Since he got back from that trip, he hardly talks to me anymore. He says he's gonna put me in a boarding school. When Mom died, he promised we'd always be pals. We're not pals anymore.
Now, let's not have any of that, Jimmy. Let me tell you something. Every boy somehow gets the idea that his parents don't love him anymore. And then he gets angry and upset, the way you are now. And then all of a sudden, he finds he's been wrong. You don't want to do that, do you? Of course not. Now, what do you say that we take you home and have a talk with your father? Maybe we can clear up this little misunderstanding. How about it? Icky, warm up the squadron car. And you better take our TV camera with us, too. You can't tell when we might need it.
There you go.
Yes? Jimmy, where have you been?
Well, is Mr. Gibson in? I'd like to speak to him, if I may.
I'm sorry. He's busy in his workroom. I'm Mrs. Drexel, his housekeeper.
Well, I'd better have a talk with Mr. Gibson. Perhaps I can clear up a little misunderstanding.
Misunderstanding?
Yes, between Jimmy and his father.
Oh, that's really not necessary. Jimmy hasn't been himself lately. You know how boys are.
What about Jimmy, Mrs. Drexel?
Why, he ran off without permission, and these gentlemen brought him home.
I know you didn't mean any harm, son, but it wasn't very nice of you to run off without telling me, now was it? No idea how worried I was. You are sorry, aren't you? Ah, of course you are. Now, run upstairs and comb your hair and wash your face and get ready for dinner.
Thanks for everything, Captain Midnight.
You're welcome, Jimmy.
So you're Captain Midnight.
Well, how do you do? How do you do? This is my assistant, Ichabod Mudd.
That's two D's.
I can't tell you how grateful I am for bringing him home. You've no idea how worried I was.
Oh, I can imagine you, probably had the police out looking for him.
Well, no. I knew he'd come home, and he'd only been gone a couple of hours.
Yes. Mr. Gibson, Jimmy has the feeling that you dislike him.
Well, I may have neglected him a little recently, but if I have, it's only because of a tremendous responsibility that I'm preoccupied with.
Well, you mean that Brazilian diamond? We've been reading about it in the magazine.
Yes, it doesn't arrive for another week, and yet already, I can think of nothing else.
Say, I have always wanted to see a diamond cutter's workshop. I wonder if it'd be asking too much if you showed us around.
Well, I'd like to, but I'm quite busy with the necessary preparations.
Oh, just a quick look?
Well, you sure would appreciate it.
Well, suppose I bring up an uncut diamond and show you how I work. The workshop's in the basement. Excuse me.
Fine.
What do you want to take a lesson in diamond cutting? You found a kid, you brought him home. Now let's get on to something more important.
This is most important. You know, things just don't add up. He told us that Jimmy hadn't been gone more than a couple of hours. Actually, Jimmy was gone all night. And he didn't even miss him.
Hey, that's right.
And I'm also wondering what he has down in that basement he doesn't want us to see. Listen, I'll try and keep him occupied. You take this TV camera down in his workshop and plant it. Here he comes.
Oh, I think I can show you, gentlemen, how we diamond cutters work.
Diamond cutting must be a fascinating work, Mr. Gibson.
Well, it is, if you can stand the strain on the nerves. Now, take this uncut diamond here. As you undoubtedly know, the diamond is the hardest substance known to man, and yet must be handled with extreme care. Before we cut the stone, we first study it very carefully. Then we score it, mark it along the line we intend to cut.
One mistake might fracture, even shatter the stone. And then, instead of this $9,000 to $10,000 diamond here, I'd have a number of smaller stones worth thousands of dollars less.
May I take a look at it, please?
Now, with the risk involved in cutting such a small diamond as that, you can imagine the tremendous strain in cutting a $1 million stone. So, is it any wonder that I've had so little time for Jimmy?
Well, I certainly do thank you for such a thorough explanation. You ready to go, Icky?
All set.
Well, I certainly enjoyed meeting you. I hope we'll meet again.
I'm sure we will. Goodbye.
Bye. Sure didn't take him long to get back to work.
Icky, there's something about that Mr. Gibson that just doesn't ring true. Like that stone he showed me. He said it was worth $9,000 or $10,000. Well, I know it's worth at least $20,000, perhaps more.
Well, so he gets drunk. So what?
So we hop in the Silver Dart and fly down to Rio de Janeiro. I want to know why a man who doesn't know diamond values is entrusted with one worth over $1 million.
For a runaway boy, and the next thing you know, we're headed for Brazil.
Call the airport traffic control for landing clearance.
This is the Silver Dart, jet aircraft 7700, calling Rio de Janeiro Airport. Over.
Putting you into any trouble, Senor De Silva?
Most certainly not. I am complimented that the famous Captain Midnight and his friend Senor Mudd desire to see the gem. Get the Bahia diamond from the vault and bring it to my office, please. Thank you.
Senor De Silva, what is your opinion of Mr. Gibson as a diamond cutter?
Unlike the other diamond cutters that I interviewed for the job, Senor Gibson is superlative in his ability.
What about his knowledge of diamond values?
He merely glanced at the gem and told me to the fraction of a carat how much it would weigh and what its value would be after cutting. But why do you ask? Is something wrong?
Well, a number of strange things have happened in the States to convince me that someone is plotting to steal your diamond, Senor De Silva.
Well, this is most shocking. Who is behind this plot?
I don't know yet, but I strongly advise you to take every possible precaution.
Thank you. And now, senors, behold the largest diamond ever to come from the mines of Bahia.
It's a magnificent stone. Truly magnificent.
It doesn't even sparkle.
But it will after it has been cut and polished.
Here, Ricky, how would you like to hold $1 million?
$1 million? Wow. Hey, someone put some grease over it.
Well, all natural diamonds have that greasy feeling till they've been cut and polished.
It is one way of knowing that they are genuine. And now, senors, will you permit me the pleasure of taking you to dinner?
Oh, I'm sorry. We must decline. We have to be back home at once. Goodbye, Senor De Silva.
Thank you for your interest. And let me assure you that the diamond, when it is sent to America, will be kept under guard every moment until it is delivered to Senor Gibson.
Fine. Goodbye.
Welcome home. You made excellent time.
Oh, we had a good tailwind all the way from the canal zone.
We got a visitor, an old friend. Mr.
Mr. Gibson. What are you doing here, Jimmy?
It's about my father. Something's wrong with him. He isn't well. He can't remember things.
Well, can't remember what things, Jimmy?
Well, like our favorite fishing spot on Lake Sherwood. We go there all the time. Now he doesn't even remember where it is.
How about that?
Well, that is strange. Seems to me your father should see a doctor.
That's what I told him. When he got real angry and slapped me. He never slapped me before.
Iggy, why don't you take Jimmy out and fix him a sandwich while I discuss this matter with Tut?
Okay. Come on, Jim.
Long distance, please. Operator, I want to speak with Senor Pedro da Silva in Rio de Janeiro, Brazil.
Time out now to relive something that happened recently at headquarters.
Testing something, Ted?
Right. I'm going to clear up some confusion about the contents of these jars. All are called food drinks, and they're all mixed with milk. So you might think they'd all make the same kind of milk drink. But really, there are three entirely different kinds here. Now these are the better known milk flavorings. They taste all right, but they're just flavorings. And this second group contains only a few vitamins and minerals, but they're still primarily flavorings. But here, we have a real food supplement, instant Ovaltine. You see, you've got to know exactly what you want in a food drink. If it's just flavoring, they're all okay. But if it's an honest-to-goodness food drink with 27 vitamins, minerals, and other important food elements that help fortify milk, then you want instant Ovaltine, our official Secret Squadron drink.
Right. And that's why you should drink instant Ovaltine every day, the drink that helps give you rocket power.
Why don't you start drinking Ovaltine today?
Well, that plane from Brazil arrived at the airport about 30 minutes ago. Surprise party should be starting any minute now.
Surprise party?
Right on time. Please wait.
Now, those are the two guards we met in the Silva's office. Are they in on the robbery, too?
I'm sure they know nothing about it. And I'm not sure it is a robbery yet.
Right this way, please.
Ah, Arturo, Miguel, you brought the diamond.
Si, senor.
Now, will you please sign? Thank you.
And tell Senor da Silva I will start working on the diamond immediately. Good day.
Good day, senor. Good day.
Turn on a television set.
Hey, look. If that's Mr. Gibson, who's that over there?
That's what I'd like to know. Turn on the sound.
$1 million. But how are you going to turn it into cash? Who'd buy a $1 million diamond without asking a lot of questions?
Nobody will recognize it after Gibson gets through with it. All right, Gibson. Start cutting it out. No, I won't do it. You can't make me. Look, Gibson, I'm shooting for $1 million. And I do mean shooting. That thing doesn't scare me. You like your boy, don't you? You wouldn't. Now, Jimmy's a nice kid. We wouldn't want anything to happen to him. Now, are you going to cooperate with us or aren't you?
Seen enough. Go get the police on the double.
I'm telling you for the last time, it's glass. Quit stalling and cut that thing.
And make it snappy.
Nothing but glass.
It's a trick. They're wise to us.
It's that Captain Midnight. Tie him up and let's get out of here.
Dad, where are you going?
What's your hurry? You're not going anyplace except to prison.
You can't send my father to prison, Captain Midnight.
This man's not your father, Jimmy. He looks like your father, but he's someone else. A jewel thief. And this one, too. And the woman, she's their accomplice. There's a stiff penalty for attempted robbery, but a stiffer one for kidnapping. I'll be down and sign the charges later.
All this for a hunk of glass.
I knew you'd help my father, Captain Midnight. My real father.
I can't thank you enough, Captain Midnight.
What I don't understand is how a $1 million diamond turned out to be glass.
Now, that was a fake diamond, a keep sent by Senor Da Silva to trap the thief, the man who looked like Mr. Gibson.
When I returned from Brazil, they held me prisoner, locked me in the basement, and only let me out when Jimmy wasn't at home.
How did you know which was the real Mr. Gibson and which was the imposter? They looked so much alike.
Well, the thief made three mistakes. Your picture in the magazine showed that you were right-handed. He was left-handed. You are an expert on diamond values. He isn't. But his biggest mistake was trying to fool Jimmy.
And when Jimmy told you his father couldn't remember anything, not even their favorite fishing spot.
I had my first important clue, so I phoned Senor Da Silva to send up a fake diamond. The plan worked. The fake diamond exposed the fake Mr. Gibson.
I must phone Senor Da Silva to send the real diamond.
That won't be necessary. Senor De Salva sent the diamond to me or you.
Gee, Pop, if you can make this round, it'd sure make a million-dollar marble.
And now, boys and girls, here is what you get when you join the Secret Squadron. This membership card with your very own Secret Squadron number, this official Secret Squadron manual, and this combination badge and decoder. Look, here's how the decoder works. I'll give you a two-word clue. The second word is in our secret code. The first word is test. Now, here is the secret code word. Write down these numbers. 18, 17, 20, 3, 4, 18. Now, set your secret decoder like this for code A3. Then decode this important clue to next week's adventure. If you don't have your decoder badge, here's how you can get one for your very own. First, get a jar of the official Secret Squadron drink, delicious chocolate-flavored Ovaltine, the food drink for rocket power. Then cut out the wax paper disc that covers the Ovaltine jar. And send that disc with your name, your address, to me, Captain Midnight, Box P, Chicago 77, Illinois. That's all. Send no money. It's free to every boy and girl who joins the Secret Squadron. And when you receive your secret decoder badge, membership card with your very own Secret Squadron number, and 12-page manual, you will be a full-fledged member. Remember, get your Ovaltine, the food drink for rocket power. Hot or cold, it's got what it takes to help you be a leader in your gang. So every day, drink instant Ovaltine. On my next mission, I'm going to test ride the fastest ground vehicle in the world, a 6-engine jet-propelled rocket sled that travels faster than the speed of sound. On its previous test run, the rider was killed. I'm going to prove that his death was not an accident, but murder. Now, don't miss the human bullet. This is Captain Midnight signing off with the code of the Secret Squadron. Justice through strength and courage. Out.